Fantastic to hear such thought-provoking questions on that panel on deterrence. So thanks so much to all our participants for sending in your questions and comments. It's been great to hear from you. Now, no strategic communications conference would be complete without a defense, and more specifically, a military perspective, particularly on the information environment. I'm really pleased to announce now Deputy Supreme Allied Commander Transformation, General Paolo Ruggiero. Sir, you have the floor.
Well, thank you very much. I hope you can hear me loud and clear. Ladies and gentlemen, distinguished guests, authorities, good afternoon. Good afternoon from Norfolk, from the US. So I'm General Paolo Ruggiero from the Italian Army, as it was already announced, and as Deputy Supreme Allied Commander Transformation, let me say that it is a great pleasure and a great privilege also for me to have the opportunity to participate at this important event. Even though I would have loved, of course, to be physically present in the beautiful city of Riga. So first of all, I would like to thank and to express my congratulations for the organization of this event to the Stratcom Center of Excellence, and in particular to the director, Mr. Yannis Sartz, for inviting me today. As you can see from this slide, the theme of my presentation is rediscovering the cognitive battlefield and what next. And let me say immediately that this is a very interesting and challenging subject. And I hope that in the next 20 minutes, I will be able to describe from a NATO perspective how the characteristics of modern warfare are evolving and why it is important to understand the implication of these changes, specifically in the so-called cognitive dimension. I will start first by giving you some insight about the role in the alliance of the Allied Command Transformation, ACT. I will then look at the current international security scenario, which is blurring the boundaries between peace, crisis, and conflict. Finally, I will enter more in detail on how the cognitive dimension impacts modern warfare and what initiative NATO should consider. But let me first make a few initial considerations before I go deeper into the subject of my presentation. More than 200 years ago, Clausewitz said that war is an act of force to compel our enemy to do our will. Well, let me say that this argument still remains valid today. Despite the fact that the nature of war has not changed, the areas of confrontation are not always physical. And an act of force is no longer purely kinetic or symmetric. New forms of warfare have emerged, extending the traditional concept of battlefield and its boundaries compared to the past. Moreover, we are living today in a world that is strongly interconnected, where information can be spread in real time just by using a smartphone, influencing a multitude of people and impacting their minds and behaviors. With the internet, we can say that also the battlefield has become global. With increasing role of technology and information overload, individual cognitive abilities will no longer be sufficient to ensure informed and timely decision making. Therefore, in recent years, the cognitive dimension has become a recurrent term also in military terminology. This new concept of warfare affects not just military personnel at the front line, but all civilian organizations and their citizens. If, in the future confrontation, we do not want to lose, we must not prepare to fight in the manner of past wars. NATO must be ready up for the next type of battle. So let me say something about ACT role and activities. The reason why NATO has been successful for more than 70 years is because the alliance constantly transforms and adapts itself in response to a changing world and to its new security challenges. And the capacity to transform and to adapt perfectly sum up also the mission's essence of Allied Command Transformation, ACT. ACT leads the constant adaptation of the alliance military instrument of power, coordinating nations' efforts to ensure coherence, interoperability, and standardization among their forces. As the Allied Warfare Development Command, AC3 transforms the military operational requirements identified by the Allied Command Operation, ACO in Mons, the second NATO strategic command, into effective military capabilities. And the complementary role between ACT and ACO ensures that the alliance is always credible and ready to maintain its advantage over any potential adversaries. In order to do so, ACT analyzes the global strategic situation to understand and shape the future security environment, identifying trends, risks, and challenges to provide military advice to support our political leaders in their decision-making, develops and deliver outputs for the warfighters in terms of military capabilities, such as weapon systems, equipment, education, training, and doctrine. To do so, ACT is also the NATO leading agent for innovation, especially in the research and introduction of new technologies, for example, artificial intelligence and autonomy. ACT leads the NATO defense planning process to assure that the member nations provide the alliance with the proper military forces to maintain its readiness and sustain operational tasks. Moreover, ACT sets standards for interoperability and readiness through education and training programs to integrate the alliance military culture. And finally, ACT connects and implements a wide network of allied nations and partners, military and civilian sectors, startups, training and education facilities, academia, and 28 NATO accredited centers of excellence. Among those is the Stratcom Center of Excellence in Riga. So if NATO can maintain its military superiority over any potential threat, it is also thanks to the important role played by ACT. Let me take a look now at the international security environment. We are all familiar with this, but I want just to highlight some specific issues. So NATO, as we know, has been successful in preventing conflicts and preserving peace for more than 70 years, as I said before. However, during the last two decades, the security environment has changed drastically with new distinct challenges and threats, which impact our global security and narrow the effectiveness of deterrence. Growing states and non-states are challenging the rule-based international order. Additionally, regional conflicts threaten global peace, while terrorism and criminal organization contribute to the spread of irregular migration, refugees, and illegal smuggling, creating instability beyond our borders. Moreover, persistent transnational challenges such as economic instability, climate change, natural disasters, and pandemic diseases further deepen the complexity and the uncertainty of the security environment. Finally, with the use of new technology and information, these threats are increasingly influencing our open societies. It is difficult to determine the source of these attacks, which exploit information and disseminate disinformation and propaganda to psychologically compromise our communication and response. A key characteristic of this evolving security context is the rise of competition for advantage. The nature of conflict, in light of the traditional role of military, has become more complex to define. The linear progression from peace to crisis to conflict is giving way to a non-linear structure. Therefore, we will face more persistent activities simultaneously across physical and not physical domains, using multiple instruments of power, not just military, with the aim of compelling, of competing and gaining the advantage. These challenges are boundless and alien to the traditional idea of battlefield. Let me just talk a little bit now about the cognitive dimension. As military members, we specifically think about actions and effects. We take actions, or we are subject to actions, in the five physical and not physical operational domains: maritime, land, air, cyber, and space. Actions are also taken in other areas, including socio-cultural, diplomatic, economic, and financial. And they are all executed within the persistent information environment. Actions causes effects in many dimensions: the physical dimension, the virtual dimension, and the cognitive dimension. What is changing today is the increasing ability for a potential adversary to act surreptitiously, targeting primarily the virtual and cognitive dimensions and imposing dilemmas in terms of response and retaliation. The information environment has extended its boundaries, which results for us in rediscovering the nature and implication of the cognitive dimension. As we know, operations in the information environment are traditionally conducted in five core capabilities: electronic warfare, computer network operations, PSYOPs, military deceptions, and operational security. In essence, information warfare aims at controlling the flow of information in support of objectives defined by the traditional mission of military organization, mainly in order to produce lethal kinetic effects on the battlefield. On the other end, operations in the cognitive dimension degrade the capacity to know, produce the thwart knowledge, where for knowledge we intend those cognitive sciences such as psychology, linguistics, neurobiology, logic, and more. Cognitive warfare is the way of using knowledge for a conflicting purpose, but is not limited to the military or institutional world. It targets the human capital, from the individual to states to multinational organizations, across everyday life, with harmful effects and outside the normal peace, crisis, conflict structure. In other words, cognitive warfare exploits the vulnerabilities of the human mind. Cognitive warfare can be compared to propaganda, where the primary aim of propaganda is to influence attitudes and behaviors of people. The main difference is that cognitive warfare pursues the objectives of undermining trust in the individual. Its goal is not what individuals think, but rather the way they think. Open societies such as those in the West are especially vulnerable of being exploited and acknowledged in their vulnerabilities. Over the past two decades, new technologies provided the potential of global outreach to everyone, connected individuals via digital means and platforms with a variety of social media outlets, including Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. These tools can be used as vehicles to influence or facilitate massive social shift in our societies. Furthermore, fake news, Trojan horses, and digital avatars will create more confusion and ultimately influence the way we think, which is prone to exploitation. Hostile actions in the cognitive dimension do not necessarily need to complement military action. They can be conducted independently because it is easier and cheaper for adversaries to undermine trust in our own system rather than kinetically attack power grids, factories, or military installations. A cognitive info campaign combines both real and distorted information, exaggerating facts and fabricating news to take advantage of pre-existing social-political confrontations, anxieties, or beliefs that predispose the target audience to accept false information. The aim of this campaign is to create more division, frustration, and anger among the members of alliances and their partners. Finally, cognitive warfare is potentially endless, since there can be no peace treaty or surrender in this type of conflict. So what are the implications for NATO? In response, of course, to this changing world and to its new security challenges, the alliance has the chance to proactively adapt and outpace adversaries in order to shape and to contest. NATO's center of gravity is based, as we know, on cohesion and trust among its members and partners. Trust is based not only on respecting some tangible agreements, but also on invisible contracts of sharing same values. The objectives on NATO's adversaries is to identify the cognitive center of gravity of the alliance, which they will target with info campaign weapons. Looking at most recent examples, both Russia and China have learned from these experiences, and alongside their military modernization programs, they shaped innovative warfare approaches to the community dimension, particularly through disinformation, deception, and fear. Russia has prioritized the cognitive warfare as a precursor to the military phase. China has an even broader definition of cognitive warfare as the systematic use of cognitive science and biotechnology to achieve mind superiority. Examples of similar activities has been most recently reported in the Baltic Seas, more specifically in Estonia, in Ukraine, in France during the 2017 presidential elections, in occasion of Brexit, and most recently against all NATO members with the infodemic campaign following the COVID-19 pandemic. So let me also say that the exploitation of human cognition has become a massive industry, developing strategies to exploit risks and opportunities. There is a challenging competition due to the rise of neuroscience and the rapid expansion of emerging technologies such as nanobioinformation technologies and cognitive sciences, which offer new and potentially infinite possibilities to manipulate brains, perception, and therefore thoughts and behaviors. These new tools and hyperconnectivity will continue to make the cognitive dimension more complex, further emphasizing for our community of interest the importance of building resilience and capacities in this area. Some NATO nations have already acknowledged that neuroscientific techniques and technologies have high potential for operational use. Nevertheless, they are also recognizing the need to address the short and long-term ethical, legal, and social challenges generated by such uses. NATO, as we know, is a defense organization. Therefore, it is essential that international laws and accepted norms will be considered in the development and use of cognitive technologies. So what next? Cognitive warfare embodies the idea of combat without fighting. As Sun Tzu said, the supreme art of war is to subdue the enemy without fighting. Whatever the nature and object of warfare, it will always come down to a clash of human wills. Therefore, what defines victory will be the ability to impose a desired behavior on a chosen audience. Today, through the extensive conduct of deception, propaganda, and disinformation campaigns, our competitors continuously seek to instill fear and increase uncertainties to disorient, disrupt, and ultimately degrade a nation's ability or will to retaliate. As part of its mission of enabling NATO to achieve its core tasks, ACT has developed the NATO Warfighting Capstone Concept, NWCC, the first in alliance history. This new concept addresses the breadth and widening operating environment across domains and instruments of powers, guiding NATO efforts in pursuing its advantage over any potential adversary in a constantly evolving and more dynamic security environment. NWCC is also guiding alliance efforts in pursuing work in the so-called human capital enhancement, because human elements are the cognitive center of gravity. So in conclusion, I would like to say that for NATO, raising the awareness and developing actions in the cognitive dimension requires sustained cooperation between allies to ensure overall coherence, develop strategies, exploit the risk and opportunities, build credibility to allow a concrete defense. More work, of course, remains to be done. That is why it is important for ACT, but I would say for all NATO, to maintain and enhance its networks with communities of experts, such as you, such as this Center of Excellence, to further build our knowledge and unify our efforts. The unique contribution, let me really address this, of our Center of Excellence, and in particular, the unique contribution and expertise coming from the Stratcom COE, are mostly needed in this important and challenging endeavor. And I would like to underline that ACT with the Stratcom COE is working together in order to develop a project on an initial concept for the cognitive domain. So NATO military edge is at stake, and our mission, of course, is to preserve it. I think that with common initiatives and efforts, such as those of this conference, I am confident that in our ability, of course, to accomplish this important mission. Having said that, I would like to thank you for your kind attention. And I would like to congratulate on behalf of ACT, but all NATO, for this very important event organized by the Stratcom COE. And again, thank you for your kind attention. And I am available for any question. Over to you. Thank you.
Lining of the innovative work and the functions of ACT. Very much appreciated. As you might imagine, we've got quite a few questions coming in, so I'll move straight to those if I can. Considering the specific role of ACT, what is the way forward for the NATO Stratcom capability development? And where do we see allied militaries in 2030 in the information environment context? Sir, you're muted.
Okay, well, thank you very much for this question. If I understood correctly, you asked me about the Stratcom capability of NATO. What next in the future of Stratcom capability of NATO? Well, of course, Stratcom is a very important tool, as we know. I think that every commander, of course, knows very well that Stratcom, the strategic communication, is one of the most powerful tools that he has in order, of course, to enhance the capabilities of the whole military instrument of power. We are working very closely, of course, with all the NATO entities in order to develop new ways of Stratcom communication and to enhance, of course, our capabilities in this. Let me say that we are very close also with the Stratcom COEs because we launched with them some project recently. Unfortunately, COVID prevented us to be probably more physically in contact. But let me highlight that when I just arrived in ACT at the end of 2019, we organized together a very important conference on communication, highlighting especially the importance of Stratcom. And that was in order also to develop, as I mentioned before, new ways, new doctrine, new capabilities, new prescription in order to support, of course, our commanders and our leadership, especially to better portray the Stratcom communication. Of course, as I mentioned also in my speech, NATO primarily is a defense organization. So for us, Stratcom should be used in order to prevent, of course, any hostile actions, but not to be, of course, proactive in order to do action against any other potential competitor. But we need to be linked together, of course. We need to ensure that our communication is constantly clear, according to the same principle. Because as I mentioned, also the center of gravity of our alliance is our unity, our unit of ends, our cohesion. So also in the Stratcom communication, we need to have the same principle and same guidance and the same way of portraying outside our image and our communication. Your second question was about the military capabilities. Can you repeat the second part of your question? Over to you.
Second part of that question was, where do we see allied militaries in 2030, specifically regarding the information environment context?
Okay, NATO 2030, you know, has been recently also disseminated from NATO HQ and from the Secretary General a vision, a document that highlights a little bit what are the progress, of course, of the security environment in the future, and also what NATO should start to think and should start to work on in order to be capable to face these new challenges of the future. There is a new concept, of course, let's say new, it's not really new, this multi-domain approach. So far, we have been considering, you know, the use of military instrument of power in singular domains: maritime, land, air, space, cyber. The new concept is that all these domains are interrelated, as a matter of fact. So we, in the future, I hope never, but in the future, if we have to fight or we have to do something, of course, this division among singular areas is not anymore possible. So the multi-domain approach is what we need to think about. And overarching this multi-domain approach, of course, for our military forces, there is also the communication domain, which is not yet a domain, but communication is something, of course, overarching all these multi-domain aspects that we need to consider. That's the reason why, again, the strategic communication is raising its interest. It will be always in the future more and more important, and we need to think about it. And this is what we are working in close coordination also with the Strathcon COE. Over.
Thanks for your insight, General. I have a question here which actually aligns with something that I personally wanted to ask, so I'm going to go to that one next. And it's regarding the agility of the adversary versus those Western democracies who are required and desirous of abiding by the rules-based international order. How can we compete with the agility of those adversaries that are able to move faster than an allied consensus-driven body needs to be? Over to you, sir.
Thank you for this question. This is a very interesting question, very challenging, but very challenging because, of course, it is clear that adversaries who don't have to rely on different opinions, for them it's easier, of course, to make decisions. For them it's easier also to have one policy, one guidance, and one way of actions. In NATO, because we are an alliance of 30 countries, of course, our force is based on consensus. I mean, on the way that all the countries are together, because again, the center of gravity of NATO is our unity of intent, is our cohesion. So in a certain way, if we compare these two principles, these two ideas, of course there is a difference, and of course we can say that probably we are more vulnerable. And that's the reason why also in my speech I mentioned that countries, the Western countries, and more specifically our countries, we are more vulnerable, of course, to be also a target of a cognitive warfare activities from adversaries. Because we live in an open society, of course. And this also has a reflection in our decision-making process, because, of course, as you mentioned, we need to rely on the understanding and also on the common decision coming from all the nations. On the other hand, I think that if NATO maintains what we call the edge, and the edge means that we maintain, first of all, our unity of sending clear messages, of sending clear messages about our capabilities, about our strength, about our unity, about our community, about our values, that of course are values that are very much important. If we are unified in this, and if we maintain also our strength and our edge in our military capabilities, I think an adversary will not take opportunities, of course, to prevail on us. And we have many ways of doing this. Let me talk about, for instance, innovation, the introduction also in our military capabilities on new technologies, new emerging technologies. We need to maintain the speed to be always ahead, to be always forward, to think and to prevent what a potential adversary can do. We have this kind of capabilities. For sure, our technologies are higher if we maintain this speed, if we maintain this edge. So I think that, yes, initially we can have some kind of problems because it's easier for a centralized government, of course, to control communication and to make decisions easier. But I think that the unity of effort of our nations and the values of our nation all together at the end will be stronger if we are capable to maintain this unity, if we are capable to maintain our edge using also, as I mentioned, new ways, such, for instance, innovation and new emerging technologies in every way. Over.
Thanks so much, sir. We just have time for one more quick question. So what kind of investment at national and alliance level would be needed to ensure appropriate readiness and capabilities relevant to the challenges we're facing now and in the immediate future in the information environment?
But let me say, I mentioned also in my speech, we are working in ACT on a project which is the human capital enhancement. Because at the end is always a factor of human capability. Yes, we can have all the technology, we can have all the instruments, very costly, but at the end is always the human being, the center of gravity. So we have this project of human capital enhancement. And I think that specifically in this area of communication, strategic communication, we need to invest on educate and training proper people, proper personnel, both military and civilians. And this is where we have to put our effort. So the combination of new technologies, new doctrine, new ways, new means, advanced kind of systems, and also advanced kind of procedures combined also with the education and training of proper personnel, this will be really the key of success. So my first answer is invest on people, invest on personnel, human capital, which is again the center of gravity, also for the cognitive dimension. Over.
General, thank you so much for your insights and for letting us know how NATO has the edge, not necessarily on agility, but on unity and strength. We're nearing the end of our agenda today and for the whole of the RSD, which is quite sad, but we're now going to move to our final panel, which is particularly pertinent in this era of constant communication and connection. So, the next panel, Living Smart with AI, Big Data, and Emerging and Disruptive Technologies, moderated by Ms. Ieva Ilvesa, Advisor to the President of Latvia for Information and Digital Policy.
The abundance of data can be the driver of innovation, as well as the reason for serious security and societal issues. But now, governments and international organizations seem to struggle with their approach to addressing emerging technologies. The first steps towards building a common understanding and ambition level still seem